This is our theme for this year. This is our theme for this year. I don't know what you were doing last year and the year before, but we're going to start living for the Son, the S-O-N, in 2021. Galatians 2 and 20 says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God. So you're living for the Son. You're not living for yourself anymore, but you live for the Son. The Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Thank you, Crystal. If you would, please rise to your feet in reference to God's word. We are coming from the book of Mark, the 38th chapter. But as we come from the book of Mark, we're going to have it on the screen. But I'm going to have you also open up to Deuteronomy 31 and 8. I normally don't do this, but these two scriptures go together hand in hand. So I'm going to read to you Mark 38, and then we're going to just flip over to Deuteronomy 31 and 8. But we'll read Mark 38 first. If you have it, say amen. And it reads as follows. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him and said unto him, Master, careth thou not that we perish? I'll say it again. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, that's the back part of the boat, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him and said unto him, Master, careth not that we should perish? Now, if you would, please turn your Bible to Deuteronomy, the 31st chapter. And look at verse 8. We're going to have that scripture up on the screen the whole time. But I want you to understand these two are hand in hand together. Because you see Jesus sleep in a boat. But what does the word of God say here as well? If you have it, say amen. And the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. We just sang the song, God of Angel Armies, and this is the scripture that it comes from. And the Lord, it is he that doth go before thee, meaning he goes before thee. We just sang, he comes behind us, and he's with us. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. You may be seated and pray with me now. Father God, we just thank you right now, Lord, that we see in your word consistency. We see in your word perfection. We see in your word that you love us, that you cherish us, that you protect us, that we should never fear of being alone. The lies of the devil tells us in our ears and in our head that you don't care for us and you're not with us. But Lord, your word is what is true. Your word is our hope. Your word is our strength. And that's where we should be coming from, holding on to, and finding and leaning on for strength and hope and salvation in Jesus. Father God, be with those in my church right now. Be with my congregation. Be with my sheep, Father God. Strengthen them, Lord, where they are weak, and build them up where they're torn down. These are a people of hope, but sometimes they get discouraged. Sometimes they get afraid. Sometimes, like all sheep, we get a little startled. We get a little rattled. Father God, we're coming into a new year. We have the fears and doubts that are hanging on a little bit from last year. Help us to shake those things off and move forward in faith in you. Father God, give us the strength we need. Father God, give us the hope that we need. Father God, give us everything we need. And we need Jesus. That's who we need the most. Lord, we thank you now in advance for that person and whosoever that wants to join our church, become part of our congregation, become part of your larger kingdom, Lord. We give thanks in the mighty name, Lord. Reduce me, make me small, but let everyone here see you, Lord, and not me. Father God, build me up where I'm torn down. Strengthen me where I'm weak. Let me be your poster boy, your newsman. Let me preach your words today. Give me everything I need, Lord, to convey your message to my congregation. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I had to give you that verse right there because of the fact that that's one of my favorite verses. And I just love that verse, but it was it's been weighing on my heart before we came in, and that's how the Holy Spirit works, that we sang that song. So that's called synergy. That's moving in it. Giving honor to God, to the saints in Christ before me, and my three precious diamonds. I'm going to keep you focused on verse 38 right now, though, because it's going to be on the screen. And in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awaken him and say unto him, Master, careth not thou that we perish? I like to speak from the thought, wake up, Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and smile at him and say, neighbor, oh my neighbor, don't go to sleep just yet. We got a phone call from Jesus. He's on hold right now. If I could describe 2020, I would say it was as if Jumanji, an earthquake, a tornado, and a hurricane all had a baby, and it would be called 2020. Just ugly. That's about right. But we adjusted. We adapted. We overcome as a church. We Zoom Bible studies. We Zoom church services. We posted our services on YouTube with the help of Crystal, our technician and technical advisor for the internet. And it wasn't because that the Facebook didn't like me either. But we preached beyond Tampa and Plant City, but we reached the world. Matthew 28:19 says, go ye therefore preaching and teaching. And that's just what we did. Cedar Grove, we opened back our doors of the church in June. We returned to the sanctuary and worshiped as a family again. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything give thanks, for it is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So let's give God some glory right now. If you wouldn't mind, give him a hand clap of praise for the fact that we are here in 2021. We're going to see in this text today that Jesus is asleep in the back of the boat. Look at verse 38 again. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awaken him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Here's why I'd like to give you three for the Trinity. My first point, we see the panicked believers. We see the panicked believers. The disciples, they panic. Verse 37 tells us that a great storm of wind and waves beat upon the ship so that it was now full of water. So they were taking on water in their boat. And if anybody's ever been on a boat before, taking on water is a bad thing. That normally means that you're in fear of sinking and drowning. Yet the whole time, Jesus is in the back of the boat snoring. Thank you, Crystal. The Bible doesn't say it, but if I could use my sanctified imagination, Jesus is in back of the boat sleeping so hard that he's drooling on his pillow. Jesus, sleep on the boat, be like just that. The Bible says in Hebrews 2:17, in all things he had to be made like his brethren. Brothers and sisters, we drool when we're sleeping really hard. We're in a deep sleep, and Jesus was sleeping so hard, he didn't even notice the storm, nor did he wake up. This caused his disciples to panic, saying, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Translation in English is, wake up, Jesus, wake up. The creator of the world, the wind, and the waves was asleep in the back of the boat. The disciples seen Jesus do all kind of miracles that only the Son of God can do. They forgot who was in the boat with them. They panicked, even though Jesus was right there with them, ever present. The disciples probably started saying things consistent with people who start to panic. We're drowning here, Jesus. We're going to die, Jesus. Help us, Jesus. Master, don't you care that we perish? That was 2,000 years ago. But let's fast forward it to today. What did you say when the coronavirus hit your house, hit a family member, hit a friend, hit someone you love? When we went into lockdown, did you panic? What did you say when you may have lost your job, couldn't pay your bills, the light, the electric, the rent, the mortgage, the car note? Did you panic? When you got ready to close down your business, when you were about to possibly shut it down if you didn't get that loan? The only difference between the disciples and you is a boat. But we all had access to Jesus, who never left us nor forsakes us. The devil will have deceived you. The devil will have you believing that Jesus doesn't care about you, that he doesn't love you. In your panic for security, in your panic for peace, in your panic for anything, just to keep you calm, the devil will have you doing things that seem right in your own eyes. Have you thinking that your best day is your worst day? But the devil is a liar. He'll have you thinking your worst day is your best day. Just ask the prodigal son who gave up the comfort of a mansion for a pig pen. He gave up filet mignon for pig slop. When it comes to a sense of return, he came to his senses and had to return home. He repented and restored his relationship with the Father. And that's what God wants to do with each and every one of us today. Somebody here needs to move closer to God. Somebody needs to move closer to Jesus. Somebody needs to know Jesus as their Savior. God woke you up this morning. God moved you here this morning. God put you in that seat this morning to come and know about Him. Don't get it twisted, my brothers and sisters, that you think you did it yourself. God is always in control of everything because you're in the boat with Jesus the whole time. He's in your life with you the whole time, whether you want to believe it or not. Latha, take a look at verse 38 again. When he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on the pillow, they awakened him and said to them, Master, carest not thou that we should perish? I'd like to give you my second point. We see the position of the Savior. The position of the Savior. Jesus is in the back of the boat. He's near the part of the boat called the tiller. This area of the boat is called the captain's chair. It's where the captain of the boat commands or controls the boat, Miss Teresa. And that's where he directs everything from there. Jesus is asleep at the wheel, y'all. Somebody say, wake up, Jesus. Now you're thinking the same thing I'm thinking, disciples are. Man, we're so done. There's water coming in. The wind is blowing. We're looking at all the things and seeing all the things. Jesus has been asleep at the wheel of the boat of your life in 2020. Jesus has been storing up a storm the whole lifetime in 2020. He's ignoring your heartache. He's been ignoring your pain, your problems. Jesus, wake up, please. I need you right now, Lord. I am so scared. That's how we all were thinking in 2020. But we're in 2021 now. We got to change some things about the way we think. Look at the Savior's position again. He was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on the pillow. Jesus is comfortable. His head is resting on a pillow. He's sleeping on one of those sleep number beds. His number is 7 for perfection, and sometimes he turns it down to 3 for the Trinity. You see, Jesus is comfortable right now. But while your life is turning upside down, I think somebody missed that. Jesus is comfortable right now while your life is turning upside down. But he is in the boat with you. Jesus said he would never leave you nor forsake you. Jesus said he is our shepherd and will lay down his life for his sheep. Jesus said no one will snatch my people out of his hands. What kind of protection? Why did the disciples panic? What kind of protection did they have? Why did the disciples panic? Why do we panic? Why? Well, no, I'm glad you asked that question. Because we don't walk by faith. We walk by sight. The text says they saw the wind and the waves splashing, coming in against them. These men, most of them were fishermen. They fished on the Sea of Galilee. So they were familiar with the winds and the waves that happened in the storms. So why is it that when a storm came up this time, with Jesus in the boat with them this time, did they panic? Why did they panic this time? Any other time when storms came up, they were always doing what they had to do because they were fishermen. But this time with a storm, they panicked? Shame on them. Because this time they had hope in a boat that knew how to float. Jesus' position was in the boat. We should focus on not what we can see, but what we know. We believe in God. Take heart. Never forget, have faith in God. Jesus' position was in the boat, but we focus on our problems. We focus on our tears and our fears, and we've been doing that this whole year. But have you decided to keep your eyes on Jesus? The same hope that kept Noah afloat through the flood. The same hope that kept fire off the 3 Hebrew boys. The same hope that allowed David slay a giant. The same hope that destroyed the walls of Jericho. The same hope that came down 40 in 2 generations, that kicked open the doors of a grave, that knocked a rock out the side, that went to the cross, that woke up on the 3rd day to save you and me from a burning hell in a grave. That same hope was in the boat. But fear didn't let them see their protection. Fear doesn't let them see their joy, their love, and their peace was right there with them, positioned the whole time in the back. something to people. Fear causes people to run, to flee, become cowards. Have we lost our focus on God, on His character, on His nature? God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We confess that, we believe that. But when trouble comes our way, why do we act like cowards and say we don't know what God's going to do? God has never changed who He was, and He will never change. We the ones that change, but God will never change. Maybe we've been so focused on ourselves that we haven't heard God talking to us the whole time in 2020. He's been talking to you. Have you checked your voicemail? But maybe your mailbox is full. Have you checked your email? But maybe you sent him the spam and deleted it. Maybe you checked your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, your Snapchat. Maybe you just stopped following Jesus altogether. You may have watched every TikTok video for these young folks in here, but God may have not been flashy enough. Maybe not cool enough for you. Maybe the things Jesus said wasn't or didn't agree with you, so you didn't share him or like him with anybody. Brothers and sisters, God has been talking to us since the beginning of the year 2020. Maybe God has been talking to you since the time that you were born till the time that is today. You do know that when the people of God and the world don't listen to Him, God lets things happen in our lives to get our attention. What that means is this: God sends problems our ways, so we don't have any reasons why we shouldn't listen to Him. But both Christians and non-believers turn deaf ears to God. And now He has to make some and take some drastic measures to get our focus on Him. We forget that God has been trying to speak to us through words, events, circumstances in your life, and situations. Even though those things are happening, Jesus is still with you in this boat, y'all. Jesus is still with you. God has orchestrated. God does the things necessary to draw you, to draw me, to draw us back to Him. His position is always a fixed place. We're the ones that wander off from where the Jesus is. We're the ones that are the lost sheep that He has to go out and find. He leaves the 99 to go pursue the one. He goes pursue the two. He goes to pursue you and me. God is trying to tell us something. When He speaks, it's clear, it's current, and the conversation may not be what you want to hear or may not be what you want to listen to, but God is going to talk. You just going to have to sit there and listen. Marty, maybe this year may have disfigured some people you know, may have injured some folks you know, may have caused them sickness. Maybe some people's plans in here got spoiled, Mike. Maybe they got ruined because of quarantine. Maybe the economy shut down. Miss Jean, you've seen people's marriages may have been broken. People's finances may have been shaken. Maybe their lives have been destroyed and broken up totally. But you know what hardships do and difficulties do? They reveal the true nature or character of a person. Those flaws that have been there the whole time show up and reveal themselves. People show you who they truly are in hard times. Jesus showed us who He truly was in a hard time when they beat Him from sunup to sunset, took Him from judgment hall to judgment hall, and nailed Him to the cross. He never stopped being a righteous Savior and God. God chose 2020 to pull back the blanket of ugly things in our lives that have been there, but we decided to ignore them. So if you told lies, you graduated from being a gossiper to a fiction writer. Maybe if you drank a little, now you're a fish swimming in your little bottle. Maybe if you pop one pill, sniff one line of coke, puff one joint, smoke that rock, now you're a full-blown pharmacist looking like a walking CVS. What time does these days and these events and this season right now say about your character, brothers and sisters? What has it revealed about you? Are you going to panic or focus on the Lord's position in your life? Let us review. We see the panic of the believers, and we see the Savior's position in our lives. But lastly, if you keep your focus and your faith in focus, it should be on our praise. On our praise. And we're going to praise Him for His presence and our breakthrough. Look at the text again. Verse 38. He was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on the pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest not that we perish? Have you been screaming the whole time in 2020, wake up, Jesus, instead of praising? Have you been screaming, God, these things are messed up in my life, but have you been praising? Have you saying, I'm tired of this situation going on in my life? But have you been praising? God is telling us that we have to focus on Him. Focus on our faith. Focus on His love for us. Focus on His word. Focus on how often during 2020 did we complain about something instead of praising about something. Did you take the time to read God's word? Study. Come to Bible study. Listen to a Bible study. In using your technology to watch it on Zoom. Did you take the time to teach? Just living your life righteously before the world and letting your light so shine that men may glorify your Father in heaven by your example. Did the whole world hear you complain instead because you didn't have your toilet paper, your paper towels, have enough money? All your wants were not met, but God was meeting your needs. Hold on for a second. That's going down somebody's street. I hope I'm knocking over your mailbox. During 2020, did your prayer change from Father, give us this day our daily bread, to Father, give me the things I wish, I want, I desire? Because you got to understand, He says, I will give you your daily bread. The scripture also tells us that He'll give us our hearts of desire, those who follow Him. If you seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, there's a priority there. Seek Him first and His righteousness, then He gives you extra things. During 2020, did we want God to change the things back to the old ways, back to our comfortable lives, give us back our old sense of normalcy that we had in 2019, but then when 2020 came? Let me tell you a quick story real quick. There was a group of people called the Israelites. They were delivered through the Red Sea, had cornflakes from heaven, that's called manna, and God provided for their needs the whole time. But the whole time those stiff-necked Hebrews walked around in the desert, they complained about doing one thing: going back to Egypt. God was trying to take them to the promised land, to the land of milk and honey, to the land that was promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But they wanted to go back to Egypt. Let's remember what happened in Egypt. What was going on in Egypt? Well, let's remember. There was meat. They always said, we had meat to eat. We had fruits. We had garlic. We had onions. They also had the killing of their firstborn. They also had slavery and rape. They also had death and bondage in Egypt. They wanted to go back to the familiar things they knew so well. They'd rather choose death than life with Christ. Ask yourself this question. God was bringing them to the promised land. God is bringing us to the promised land. Do you want to go back to the things that were in 2019? Or do you want to move into 2021 with Christ? Do you want to go back to, I'll say it again, to the hard, the difficult, the rough, the tough things? They wanted to go back to Egypt. Do you want to go back to Egypt? Or do you want to move forward into what Christ has planned for you? To God be the glory. God only knows how to do one thing. He only moves forward. He don't go backwards. That's why we don't have time travel. That's only for science fiction. And I love some science fiction. Y'all are still here. You're not 6 feet under. You got reasonable health and strength. And we are going over to the new year today. Look at the control God has over our lives. The same Jesus who controls the wind and the waves can tell the storms of your life, the storms of my life, the storms of our lives, peace, be still. The same Jesus that said to the dead things in your life, rise and walk, can remove that blindness of sin and heal your body, restore your health, restore your life. But you gotta trust Him. You gotta believe in Him. If God did it before, He can do it again. I'm gonna say that again because somebody didn't shout on that. If He did it before for you, He'll do it again. Did He not keep the lights on in your house through 2020? Did He not put food on the table in 2020? Did He not put food on the table yesterday, the day before, and the day before? I don't see nobody on a fasting plan. I don't see nobody passing out from hunger. He feeds us, He clothes us, He preserves us, and He's kept us for this day. You gotta believe in Him. Take your eyes down to verse 39 and look what the Savior does. He arose, He rebuked the wind and the waves and said to the sea, peace be still. And look what happened. The wind ceased and there was a great calm. Brothers and sisters, you got to stop faking it till we make it. God has removed all those evil things in our life that you thought was important in 2020. He broke you down. He stripped from you all the things you thought was important. Removed the things you thought that you could hold close to him, Miss Anita, than him. He exposed the things that you didn't want people to see about you. He deleted those things that you wanted to save. God is trying to update our software to get rid of those viruses that keep attacking your faith. You see, the party's been trying to put us back together. Will you trust Jesus this year? Will you give him your faith? Will you hold on to his unchanging hand? Only Jesus can bring you peace that you so desire to the ends of storms in your life. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans not to harm you, but to give you a hope and a future. You see, Jesus has planned to give us life. And here's the thing about it. He plans to give us life more abundantly. Look at the text again, verse 38. He was asleep in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. I'm going to read the next part where I was in Deuteronomy. And the Lord, it is he that goes before you. It is he that will be with you, and he will not fail you, neither forsake you, fear not, nor be dismayed. It's the same thing. He's in the boat with us. He's with us in us our situations. Jesus has positioned you and me for success. Don't panic. Praise. Praise him for your joy. Praise him for your peace. Praise him for your prosperity. Praise him for your protection. Praise him for what you need in 2021. Not what you want, but what you need. Somebody say, yes, Lord. In 2021, are you ready for his blessing and not curses? Are you ready for his love, not hate? Are you ready for calm, not chaos? Somebody say, yes, Lord. You're ready for hope, not hopelessness. You're ready for good, not evil. Healing, not hurt. Somebody say, yes, Lord. You're ready for comfort, not confusion. A set up, not a setback. You're ready for cake, not crumbs. You're ready for victory, not defeat. It is the end. 2020 was last Thursday. 2021 is today. We've got to decide whether we're going to start living for Jesus or for the world. Think about it. Decide on it. For the unsaved person in the house, you've already dodged that bullet once. God let you live all through 2020, but you won't take a chance on being an unrepentant fool and soul to come into 2021 that way? Try that and see how well that works for you. Ask those people out there in that graveyard to your left and to your right. To the Christian who's been playing around playing churchy, it's time to get real. It's time to start acting correct for Jesus. It's time to start living for Jesus. He died so that you can live. He rose so that you can have everlasting life. Will you start serving him today? Will you start living for him today? Jesus is our life. He's already got your life in his hands. Let me tell you a secret, y'all. Come on a little closer. He's always been in control. We just got to start believing and accepting that. Nancy, look at verse 35. Randy, at the beginning of it, it says that they were going over to the other side. Let us pass, Jesus says, and go to the other side. The thing that we get scared about in verse 35 is there were other little boats in 36. They never talk about what happened in those other little boats that were going over. See, there was like a little flotilla. You know, they had the Gasparilla, they had that little flotilla. Well, Jesus was in the boat with the disciples, but there were other little boats floating with them. The storm was raging and was flapping around on them as well. But the disciples had Jesus in the boat. How scared do you think those people who did not have Jesus in their life? That's representative of all the people who did not have faith. But the people who are supposed to have faith, that's me, that's you. We're in the boat with Jesus. We have hope that can flow. So my message to you, Margie, is this. Verse 35 says there's a lot of things we're trying to forget in 2020. All the bad news, the loss, the pain, the heartache, the COVID-19. There's a lot of things we want to leave behind. But Jesus told his disciples, and he's telling us the same thing. Let's pass over into 2021 to the other side. Let me help you put it like this. When you sat down in your seat this morning, you told your neighbor in the pew to move over. There was 10 in the bed and the little one said, roll over. When you were playing basketball, you might have had a crossover. When they messed up your order, they messed you over. When I play basketball, I have knees so bad now, all I do is fall over. Now when you're barely making it and you're getting by, they call that getting over. When my plane got delayed, they call that a layover. When people seem to be taking advantage of you all the time, they call you a pushover. Now, after Christmas Day, New Year's Day, and Thanksgiving, we have leftovers. I'm a bald-headed preacher with one hair hanging on to my head, Sasha, and they call that a comb over. When I'm speaking life to you, I'm speaking life over you today. When I need joy, when I need peace, when I need comfort, healer, and a deliverer, I ask my Lord, my Savior, Jesus, to come on over and see about me. Yes. I'm done. Here's the thing I want to get to you as we move into this new year. The Bible has recorded, the Bible has positioned for you and me for 365 days, 365 times, it says, fear not. One for each day of the year. 365 times it says, fear not. So that's one for every day. Now, I know somebody said, but what about that leap year, Pastor Stewart? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. When we have a leap year, God has already supplied for all our needs according to his riches and glory. He's given us our daily bread for that leap year. Somebody say it, sweet name with me. Somebody say, Jesus. He is the bread of heaven. He is our life. He has positioned Jesus on that leap year just in case somebody didn't want to believe in him, so that those who are out of Christ can hold on to Christ and be part of his Christ, because he's in the boat that gives us hope that while we float. The question for you today is this. I'm hoping y'all read your Bible. Will you return to Egypt back to 2020, back to 2019, hoping for things to go back the way they were? I'm going to tell you, this is science. God created science. God created everything. If this is a virus, and we know that viruses mutate, they change, they adapt, they overcome, they do all those things. What will the virus do in 2021? What will the virus do in 2022? No matter what the virus is going to do, God's still going to be in control. God is the one that's in control. We may have to wear masks a little longer. We may have to get a couple of shots in our arms. Because last time I checked, we get one flu shot. Now they give us another flu shot to update from the last flu shot, and so on and so on and so forth. I don't think that's going to change with the consistency and my limited knowledge on viruses. But I do know one thing. If you get one shot, you got to get another. But here's the thing. Will you return to Egypt or will you trust in God? That despite whatever changes, whatever happens, whatever goes on in our nation, whatever goes on in this world, God is still in control. So I just don't want to leave you thinking this, the trouble stops, because the disciples were in the boat. But if you ever read Mark and you get a chance to get home, read Mark chapter 5. The trouble didn't stop right there. As soon as they got off the boat, they ran into a demonically possessed man who was violent, who was angry, and ready to fight them. Think about that as we move forward. But here it is again. It was Jesus who was with them the whole time. It may look like Jesus might be sleeping in your life, but maybe it's because you ain't been focusing on him. It may be that Jesus may be sleeping in your life because you don't know him. But if you're a born-again believer, Nancy, a child of the one true king, Jesus is operating every day, all day, on your behalf. So if you rise to your feet, let us petition, let us pray for, let us grab someone, let us beg someone, let us recruit someone to come to Christ. If you rise to your feet in honor of God's word, there may be someone who doesn't believe in Jesus right now. There may be someone who don't know Jesus for the salvation of their soul. There may be someone in here that forgot all about who Jesus is. Maybe they don't have a church home. Yes. And they want to be part of this great, awesome family called Cedar Grove. Nothing stays. Whatever the case may be, I'm hoping that today is the day that you decide to give your life to Christ. I'm praying that today is the day that you decide to put down those things, to leave those things behind, and come forward and grab a hold of Jesus. There is only salvation in one name. It is not Muhammad. It ain't Buddha. It is Jesus. It is is in the mighty name of Jesus that every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess that he is Lord. Will you be the one today? There's only one thing you have to do is confess and say, I believe in Jesus as my Savior. You believe it in your heart that God raised his son Jesus from the dead. You shall be saved. There's no extra things you gotta do. Just believe. There is no other name. There is no other name that by which man can be saved. Will there be one today? If you are outside of Christ right now, if you're standing on the outside looking in, hoping that just being good, but your good works can't measure up, they can't save you. There is no good works you can do to be saved. Jesus did all the work on the cross for you. He said it is finished. It is done. You just have to trust in him, the Son. Will there be one?
Miracles unfolding.
Thank you, Christy.
At the mention of your name.
My prayer for my church, for my people, for my church family, is that we look forward and not behind. I gave the analogy, I'm going to use it again before we go, that we have a windshield that's and a rearview mirror. Is to look, just to check every once in a while, look back over. Just look back over and thank God for the deliverance from what you used to be. But the windshield is bigger. It shows the bigger picture to see the things that are going to be, the future that God has for you, the hope that God has for you. Let us focus forward in 2021. Let us start living for the Son. Let us live for Jesus.